So on this day, we have to pray that this teaching will not be in vain on myself, that I will really catch what all it says, and I will become myself pure devotee. I will try to please him in this way. I will become pure devotee, no more material desires, no more aspiration for something else, no more pratishtha, no more puchinati, kapata, and all these things. So much power, so much. So it is not finished. It is not the hour of the day. Let's go back home, back to Maya. It's not the way. No, Buddha has left, but he has left us for so much. So we have to take these things, all the things, and also we have to come for Gold Mangal Parikram, again, come. What is this science? Come. But it's not because it will not be here. Oh, I will not come. I have no time now. So now, so much to do. Follow his instruction, read his books, chant Hare Krishna, become happy, become Krishna conscious, make the life perfect. Please.
He said, it's just like when Radha and Krishna are together, he said, they know nothing else. They're completely absorbed in one another. And they don't understand where they are or what they're doing or anything. They're just absorbed in their pastimes. They don't even understand who they are. And so there's no remembrance. He said, but afterwards, when Radharani is separated from Krishna, then she remembers everything. And all the details of their past lives come to her. He said, this is Viraha. And so, it's like that also with Maharaj. We're remembering all the details. And I was remembering how, when I first came here, I was listening to the classes, and I thought they were very wonderful. I wanted to hear. I'd never met anyone who could speak so captivatingly as he did. And his intelligence is just as amazing to me. And so I liked the classes. But I wasn't really his follower. I just wanted to come and hear the classes whenever I could. And then one devotee asked me to work on one of the books to help with the editing, because I didn't really have much experience, but I had some experience, and so I began to work on Javatara. And after I began to work on Javatara, my relationship with Maharaj changed. And I was a little mystified by it, because it's like his dealings with me changed. He suddenly began to tell me what to do. And I noticed this. I didn't notice it at first, it was only later that I noticed it. And then I realized that actually he had made me his. It's like by doing this service, he had kind of taken me. And it was wonderful when I realized it. By then there was no question. But I realized that as soon as I began to do service, then this is the Guru. As soon as you begin to serve, then he makes you his. And one way that it happened, there was a speaker, Raghavendra, just a few minutes ago. She's such a wonderful devotee, and I've seen in so many ways how Maharaj is so fond of her. So one time I was in, it was at the house in Delhi, maybe, I don't know, 98, I'm not sure. But it was around the season, it was bail season. And I was in Delhi and I went to see, I heard he was there, and so we went to see him and brought him to his house. And he told me, he was very happy to see us, and he sat down. And then he said, why did I come to Delhi? I was living in Vrindavan. So why did I come to Delhi? And I said, well, I was looking for books. Oh, and why did I want books? Well, I was planning to go to the university, so I was looking for some research books. Oh, and why was I going to the university? Well, I was going to get a master's degree. Oh, and why did I want the master's degree? And I said, well, Maharaja, I just came to India for a year and I was going to continue my studies. Why is that necessary? And I said, well, I wanted to, have a certain career. And he said, you have a career. You're a devotee of Krishna. What other career do you want? And so then I said, well, I never thought I'd have to prove myself. And then he was saying, I said, well, I was thinking, in Bhagavad Gita it says that that one should offer the fruits of one's work to Krishna. And so this was my idea. And he said, that's karma yoga. We practice bhakti. And so all of this conversation is taking place in Ramalika's living room. And meanwhile, he's carrying on a conversation with other people at the same time. He would turn to me and say something. And then I would say something and he would, give his answer. Then he'd turn to somebody else and begin to, continue with the conversation with them. And then he'd turn back to me and, maybe what do I have to say? So then I was thinking, Maharaj, what about acting according to your propensity? Because when I started university, I could see, it was like, I really fit in. I thought, wow, just like a hand fitting into a glove. I thought the way those people think, I can understand their minds. And so I felt like I was acting according to my propensity. And so I said, well, what about that one should act according to his propensity? And then he said, you do bhaja and your propensity will change. I thought that's what I just couldn't say anything. But at the same time, I was still determined to go to university. And so that was a bail season. Bail season is like around Gaur Purnima time or afterwards. Yeah, after Gaur Purnima time. And between then and September, I would see him many times. And each time I saw him, he would argue with me. And he would tell me in so many ways not to go to university, that I shouldn't go. And it was like he would sometimes he would yell at me, and sometimes he would be really sweet. And sometimes he would be sarcastic. And sometimes he would ignore me. And sometimes he would plead. He was so wonderful. And the whole thing was so traumatic to me because I had this desire and I was defying him that I couldn't go into his presence without bursting into tears, no matter what. Even before he even spoke to me. I was really traumatized. And at the end, I did go. I went to England. As soon as I got there, I broke out in a fever. I had a fever for a week. And they put me in the hospital. psychological, because I had left. And I thought that he would never speak to me again. And I was so afraid. But then he came to Wales a year later, not less than a year later, he came to Wales. And I remember he was really sweet. And he accepted me back. And then he said, "Any questions?" And I had just, some people had expressed some doubts to me that I couldn't answer before. I had expressed it to, it was this, that in Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Prabhupada's time, they had, the devotees were not allowed to read certain books, like the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, the Shastras, and books like this. And I was confused. Somebody had asked me, why was this? And I didn't really know. And so that morning I had seen Srila Madhava Maharaj and Ramchandra Prabhu. And I had asked them, well, you know, why in the Bodhi month did they do this? And then Madhav Maharaj had explained to me that in Srila Bhakti Siddhanta's time, there was so much sahajism going on. And so because of that, that he was very strict with the devotees about what they read and what they discussed. And so I could understand that. And then, so when Maharaj, when I went to see him for darshan, and he said, "Any questions?" And he was so sweet. And then I asked the same question. Well, how come they ban these people in the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam? And these books. And he looked at me and he said, in ISKCON, when they tell you not to go see Srila Narayan Maharaj, what do you do? And I said, I go see him. No question. And he said, yes, exactly, just like that. And in that way, he answered my question. But he was so, he's so captivating. He's so charming and he's so intelligent. He was so sharp. Could never get away with anything. And anyway, I don't know how much time I have, Maharaj. I can speak more. Okay. But I was thinking how also, now they say that the spiritual master's heart is a thunderbolt, soft as a rose. And I've seen Srila Prabhupada also like this. And I have personal experience also with Gurudev. His deathbed is like this also. With Prabhupada I saw that he was hard as a thunderbolt, that soft as a rose. With Maharaj I experienced this. Soft as a rose, hard as a thunderbolt. But there was one time in Hawaii. I'm not sure if I was leaving or if he was leaving. But I remember it was going to be the last time I was seeing him for some time. And we were on the North Shore at Vrindavan's house. And I had come, And Brenda and Dr. Mitchell were there, and we were sitting with him. And he asked them if the luxuries had bloomed on the mango tree. And that was the first time I realized that luxuries were other than Tulsi. Because when Prabhupada came in with the name luxuries, he said that this is the fruit of the Tulsi plant. And so he was talking about the luxuries on the mango tree, and he was talking about luxury in the conversation, he kept saying the name Manjari. And it was just like, it was so, so sweet. And in this way, it's like he captures your heart. And then, after the others had left, I had a question that had been on my mind for a long time, and that I had been chanting for so many years. I've been chanting Hare Krishna, chanting the mantra for so many years, yet still my heart was so hard. And still I feel like, God, I still haven't made any advancement after chanting for so long. And I was saying, how can I chant? And then he completely changed. And he looked at me and he said, you have to prune. Do you know how to prune? He's saying, sweet. You know how? And he said, you have to prune all the anarthas. Otherwise, you will never become one of us. Oh, so heartbreaking. It was so strong. But at the same time, it was so wonderful. It was like, when you surrender to the spiritual master, then he chastises you. Just like Srila Bhaktisiddhanta said that the sadhu, if the sadhu flatters you, and he says sweet words, then you can understand that he's flattering and you're not ready to hear. But this sadhu cuts, like the word sadhu, sadhya is the goal. And so sadhu is something that reaches the goal. It's a sharp object cuts through to the goal, like an arrow or like a knife. Prabhupada used to say, sadhu means knife. But that's what he was referring to. To show about this, so and I'm just saying that the sadhu is like a knife, cuts like a knife. And when he sees you ready, then he'll begin to cut away. And so, this chastisement is great mercy. And so, these things I was remembering. At this time, we have we we have to take shelter of our remembrances. He's given us the greatest gift. For me, He's given me a relationship with Srila Prabhupada that I never had before. He's giving me an understanding of what Srila Prabhupada has come to give and what He's come to give. He's given us this relationship that with Srila Rupa Goswami. This is one thing that Maharaj stressed over and over, that we are in this Rupa Nagamai. We are followers of Srila Rupa Goswami. And like it was mentioned by Amadar Maharaj, was that we are Gaudiya Vaishnavas, but what does it mean? And in what way are we Gaudiya Vaishnavas? Mahaprabhu had many disciples. But his foremost disciple who understood his heart's desire is Srila Rupa Goswami. Maharaj has stressed this over and over again, to understand the inner mood of the Guru. He was telling him the understanding of the inner mood of Srila Prabhupada, to understand how he was just like following Srila Rupa Goswami and understanding what Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has come to give. I'm so, so grateful that He's given me this. And He's clarified, just like as Prabhu was saying, that He's clarified for us what Srila Prabhupada has come to give. Because it's the same. This is Emperor and Parah. They're all giving the same thing. And it's, I can never repay. I only hope that I'll be able to continue to serve Him. It's said that after the disappearance of the Guru, this is the test of the disciple, that we can continue to be absorbed in the Shravan Guru Seva. Seva that is completely selfless and completely pleasing to the Guru.
Anyone else would like to make an offering?
So happy that he has lotus feet. So he was asking us about our rounds and what we're doing in life and just this wonderful charming capturing us. And then he said, "You're so lucky because girls your age couldn't get this close to Srila Prabhupada as you were getting close to me." So this poem I wrote this 2 days ago. "I can feel you in my heart, hearing you saying we are never apart. Like water in its wetness and fire in its heat, I pray to remain a particle of dust affixed to your lotus feet. As a shower of rain does not discriminate where to drop its water, similarly, out of your causeless mercy, you accepted me as your darling daughter. You traveled the world for so many years, bestowing on us bhakti to remove our fears, patiently teaching us the path to be happy in life. For without devotional service, there's only struggle and strife. You lovingly took me on half of your year's touring, and whenever I get sick, you were even worried. How can a lame jiva like me engage in Vishwa Maina and no seva? To you, Shiguru, who is more than any deva. You led by example how to behave as a devotee. Deep bhajan, never criticizing, more tolerant than a tree. You came, just as did Mahaprabhu, to bestow Braj praying, and to chant and relish the holy names. Not only that, to become a maidservant of Srimati Radharani. Coming from maidservant and Pallyavasi. How can I understand such high goals? For only you know the way of my soul. Your mercy is all that I look for. For this life there's nothing more. O Gurudev, today on your most divine disappearance day, these few foolish words are all I can say."
Om Adhyam Adhyam Sagana Nishala Chakshuram Sritam Yena Tasma Shri Namo Vishnu Maraya Rati Bharatiyasana Shri Shumantam Kedantanam Vandana Taita Mohi Kata Shakti Hari Dhamma Buddhi Doshita Mahuka. Well, I'm very junior and I never had much association of Gurudev. So as Vivekananda Das said, Tathapi Kera Bhagya Manera Ullas Doshita Mahuka. Well, I have enthusiasm to glorify my Gurudev that, and I pray to the Vaishnava that they gave me 1,000 mouths that I can glorify my Gurudev for my whole life, for my eternal life. Gurudev has given us, in the form of those mantras, he has given us everything. If you follow him sincerely, you will realize that. You will truly realize that Brahmanda Pramita Kone Bhagyavana Jeeva, Guru Krishna Prasadika. But how fortunate we are. We are yet the most fortunate soul of this universe that we have received Sadguru in the form of Shri Gurudev. Well, today when there was Viram also going on, Shripad Deer Maharaj made one point which touched my heart. Shripad Deer Maharaj said that Gurudev, so many Vaishnavas from all over the mats, they were glorifying Gurudev. Shripad Deer Maharaj said that Gurudev never thought at all his disciple of Shripad Bhakti and Raman Goswami Maharaj or Bhakti Pramod Puri Goswami Maharaj. So I was thinking that, truly, if you see in the 100 years of history of Gaudiya Math, Srila Gurudev is the only Vaishnava Acharya under whom so many disciples from all different gurus are taking shiksha. Guru Maharaj is the only personality you can see 100 years of history of Gaudiya Vaishnavism. No, if after disappearance of Gurudev, the disciples become Acharya like this, but Srila Gurudev in Assam, disciples of Bhakti Vedanta Swami Prabhupada, Bhakti Raman Goswami Maharaj, Bhakti Sri Siddhanti Goswami, Bhakti Pramod Puri Goswami, so many, everyone taking shiksha from Gurudev. And Gurudev, the Deer Maharaj was making a point, the workers tried to connect. Always, if you read Gurudev, like ISKCON not different from Gaudiya. We are same, we are all there. He always stressing that. That the one family. He always tried to unify everyone, you know. And it was something amazing. So he is truly Yugacharya. Once Shiva Kapira Shri Dharmada Jubilant Festival, he said, Shri Chaitanya Mano Vishnam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Soyam Narayanam Tadami Yena Tadami Sapanami. He said, what Rupa Goswami path came to establish? Deena Mojitayana Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It is Shri Gurudev was preached all over the world. Gurudev has fulfilled the desires of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. All over the world he has given in his books, in his lectures, in his... Everywhere, he is always stressing. Especially his book that, Pinnacle of Devotion, very beautiful compilation. When I first read it, wow, amazing. The one verse, Anadvip Sarim Chirak, Tarunyam Kinnakar, Samarpayam, Anudvodhyam, Namsav, Purata Sundara, Tikadam, Kudaridayam, Darimahasakam. I was truly amazed at one verse, Gurudev, one full book. It's amazing. Gurudev is stressing how, you know, Mahabhubh has come to give Anudvodhyam, Namsav. Well, I don't know much, but I just wanted to glorify Shri Gurudev, so don't have much words for what he has given me. I would say it's truly the Yugacharya, and I would pray that to Gurudev that he give me the service of, I didn't want much service of Gurudev, but I pray that I get the service of eternal survivors, those who have truly followed him and those who have taken his teachings to his heart, those who have taken, kept their lives in their hands and have served them. So I pray that if I can serve them, by their mercy I can realize what is the depth of Gurudev, what is the height of Gurudev. One sadhana.
Everybody left to go to work for the first time. I was try some advice on my phone. And go to start with Prajnanasana Maharaj. So he was walking one walk. So we're walking and on this playground, and this recreation pathway. And Gurudev, I was talking about enough about yesterday morning. Gurudev was walking like drunk, always drunk. Like he was just not present. We would have to stand outside because he was just totally intoxicated. And he came, he went up there and then down. One time he stopped and he was doing the stretching and breathing. And as he was doing that, two drunk, very drunk men came towards him. And I was like, oh, Jagat Mother is coming to make this. And Rajanath was kind of watching out a little bit, you know, just in case they did something. And I walked up to him and I was like, hey, old man! Around. But Gurudev came back to me. He was doing this, I was standing on the kind of stairway. And I was kind of looking at, you know, this controlling, like, we're in a different consciousness. And then Gurudev turned around to me, and he had tears coming out of his eyes. I'm seeing those people.
Like this, I want you to chant 64 go. I'm in one place, not moving. Yeah, we know that we are in separation, but if we just follow him, especially his maybe chanting and also his books, I think we can also really have a new group there. Thank you. Thank you.
The way he reacted was, to draw an analogy, was like
someone had lost their, you know, like in a romantic fairy tale, like someone had lost their fairy tale lover for 100 years and then just saw them again for the first time. Maybe they thought the person was dead. You know, like, he took that club and he clutched at his bosom like someone like a soulmate that he loved. He clutched that stuff up onto his chest so tightly, like he just snatched it out of my hand. How did you express like this? And he held it on his head like he was so exalted just to like he had never touched that on the body in his life. He took it on his head like this. And he gave it to me and said, "You should offer this to your partner." After some time when I had problems with being a brahmachari, I told him that. And then, although everyone assured me that he would chop off my head, or he would send me away and never look at my face again, I was so sure. Actually, the first time I had such an experience was when I took Karyam. I had promised my friends that I would get his blessing because their friend was the owner of the house that he was staying in, and she was extremely ill. And so they said, "You're going to see him today in your heart of initiation, so try to get his blessings that she'll recover." And the whole darshan had gone by and I had forgotten to mention that. So I went and said, "Oh, Shivpuri, by the way." And he had so finished with the darshan that he was making a straight line to the bathroom. He even had his Brahmin's hair halfway around his ear. So when I said, "Oh, Shivpuri," everyone in the room said, "Can't you see?" But Shivpuri was simply turning and very nonchalant, just popped the thread out of his ear, put his arm around him, looked at me right in the face, and said, "What?" So I was very confident that he wouldn't bite my head off like I would say he would. And I told him, as I sat with him in the room, there was maybe only one or two other people present in the room. His room was so peaceful and warm like it always is, very peaceful and sunny and warm. And Shivpuri was just so fuzzy and warm, just very friendly. And he looked at me in the eyes with such concern, very beautiful eyes. And he said, "So you want to marry me?" And I said, "Yes." He said, "You love her?" And I said, "Yes." Well, the trouble is, in Grihastha Ashram, you can't wear satin on the bottom. I guess it's like his biggest worry. "You will have to wear white cloth, which is not that bad." You know, that was his attitude. Like, well, it's kind of a demotion, but if you wear white cloth and you say senior Vaishnava, then okay. You'll survive, you know. But I didn't get married. And then after a long time, he actually, he did something really funny, which is that he seemed to forget completely about that whole incident. So when he saw me in my club, it was on the Jasmine Ruby Day in 2003, no, that was. I simply went up to the glass and started to give my flowers to him. And when I went up, before I could do anything, he just looked at me and said, "What happened to my club?" And the thing that really jumped out at me was my clock, like someone, like, you know, you give someone like something like, "Oh, here, have my chatter," and then they lose it. You're like, "I gave you my chatter," you know. It was just like, it made me so bummed out, like, "Oh, you lost it. What happened to it?" You know, and I could just see that. It was sort of like, "I gave you my clock." I was like, "Wow." It was like Mahaprasad. Like I let you, I dressed you up in my outfit when you didn't like it or something.
And just seeing that whole realization in his few words, all I could do was just drop my head in his lap and say, I'm sorry. And he was patting me on the back and rubbed my back and he said, it's okay, don't worry. And I went, and then the next day he said something else about it. And the next day he said something else about it. So then I said, so Kurdi, let me get this straight. You want me to go get some clothes, bag up, and start wearing them? He just very gravely looked me in the eye and nodded and said, like, yeah, now you're doing it. In very, very particular like that. And then I pleased him in that way for a lot of years, and then after a while I couldn't handle the stress of it and I stopped wearing it again. And after a while, as if he just had it, like, in his far out state of existence, it took modern knowledge to finally just, like, you know, stick in the, you know, he just had to say, Kuri, look, don't you know who you're looking at? This is Dinabano. Like, he hadn't even realized, he didn't recognize him with long hair or jeans on or something like that. He was like, you know, he was just, oh, that was kind of like Dinabano, but that couldn't be him, you know, or something like that. So Madhu was just, that's him. Remember, he gave him Sapphire Club. And he was like, I want to see tomorrow where he's at my butt. And Sahadev, that was in the Turaman. Sahadev, Kruk sat there with me saying, okay, we're going to do this. And I was like, no, we're not. I so then when that was the before Kharki, so then the next day when he arrived in Gokana and Ravani to be in Vrindavan for Kharki, he did something really funny. He looks at me, and he looks down at his sleeve, sat on it, and he looks at me again, like this, and like, makes the eye connection with me. Get it? He still has the hand in the feedback, so he just was right across the face with the whole feedback and everything. So, like I said, it's very hard to talk about these things because, you know, it's an amusing for Vaishnavas and it's sweet in a way, but it's like passing grace. You know, they also say that the saffron, which is a very common ingredient in sweet ice, is actually quite poisonous. If you ever take saffron directly in your stomach, it has a very pretty color and a very nice medicinal effect, but if it's not buffered with a lot of milk and sugar, saffron goes in the stomach. You'll find out why the Ayurvedic word for saffron, the Sanskrit word for saffron is naga keshav. That means the cobra's poison, deadly poisonous. So, Srila Guru knows his mercy, deadly poisonous, very, very, very sharp poison. So he's given us an ocean of sweet pastimes to drown it out in. We all like to remember those sweet pastimes. My favorite is the very first pastime I ever had with him, which is the day that I met him. Somehow, out of his busy life on earth, the many important contributions to his sampradaya, the mission of Jitan Mahaprabhu, he finds time for insignificant people like us, or rather myself. I never ceased to baffle my mind that in 91 years, somehow he's got, you know, a few minutes there, a few minutes here, another few minutes there, and sometimes even one insignificant person, he'll have like several, like, hour-long sometimes occasion. I'm like, how does he find it so worthwhile to waste time on people like me? But when the first time I ever met him, we were completely alone. There was just nobody there, and I couldn't figure out. I was like, how is this happening? Doesn't he have thousands of disciples? Where are they all right now? And he was just chit-chatting. He asked, the first question he ever asked me in his life was, where's the ball from? You know, look at the ball. Well, so it's made in Italy. And he chit-chatted me, what's your name, where are you from, and all sorts of things like that. Then, without any warning, he seemed to change the conversation. He just lays right into me, something which caused me a lot of pain and suffering in the past few days. He said, so you should know you're not his body. You may like to be in your body now because you're young, but one day you grow old, you won't like to be in your body anymore. And who will take care of you then? So you should write to me. And I decided to take initiation from him. The day that I went to take initiation from him, the way the darshan began was I was waiting outside the room, and one of the gurus said, could you hold this one, please? It was a painting of Krishna that we all know and love.